Hey guys, thanks for joining today's call. My name is Anupam Bonanthaya. I'm the Chief Marketing Officer at Aujas. Let me spend a couple of minutes talking about Aujas and what we do. So we help manage information risk. So we are an information risk management company we work with around 400 customers across the globe, across India, APAC, Middle East, and US in 22 countries. And we have around 380 people across the globe. We have a global delivery model, which is distributed across the three regions. And we follow a lifecycle services approach, which is helping you with strategy, implementation, and sustenance of information risk management solutions. We have accelerators for customers, which helps you to get started quickly. And we have 6 offices, 3 in India, 1 in Middle East, and 2 in US. And we are invested, Series B funded by IDG, which is a sister concern of IDC and other investors. And let me talk a little bit about what we do very quickly. We do 3 things. One is the services side, which is we help you across with a holistic approach to information security, and we are a pure play player. So though we work with different vendors, we look at it from a best practices perspective and see what is the best solution. So we have different practices, starting from risk advisory, which is about helping you with GRC and compliance, and then we have identity and access management, access control and access management area. Then we have threat management and vulnerability management related to VAPT and assessments and the remediation side of security. Then we have security intelligence and operations. And finally, we have digital security, which is about a specialized area, which is into digital business and IoT and the latest things that are happening in the digital area. So this is about the professional practices. And then we have our platform, which is an advanced security analytics and visualization platform. It is basically a custom-built analytics platform for security, and the use cases can be customized to your specific area of and the context of your organization. So, for example, it can be used for vulnerability management. It can be used for data leakage. It can be used for third-party risk assessments. It can be used for SIM, so on and so forth. And then we have the managed security services. So we can manage the security for you in terms of we bring in the platform and we add the services on top of it and we deliver different solutions as a managed service. So this is about Aujas. In case you want to know more about us, please feel free to get in touch with us and we can have a separate session to talk about what we do. Now, coming to today's session, it is about the information risk and cybersecurity in the Indian pharma sector. It's a very interesting area in the pharma sector, pharma industry currently, and we want to spend today time on talking about the challenges and what you need to do in the pharma sector. Now, let me introduce the 3 speakers. We have 3 speakers today. We have Chandra Prakash Suryavanshi, who is the SVP and head of India and APAC. We have Anand Mohan Nair, who is the lead consultant for risk advisory services in Aujas. And we have Deepak Simon, who is the solution advisor for IAM, which is Identity and Access Management. So we have 3 speakers covering the session today. Now, before I hand it over to Chandra Prakash, let me talk about a couple of housekeeping rules. Number one, we have muted all the audience, reason being to avoid background noise. But having said that, we do encourage you to ask questions and give us feedback. So the way you can do that is by using the chat session in front of you. So you can, at any time during the session, you can share, ask questions or share your feedback and comments using the chat session, and we'll make sure to answer those questions at the end of today's session. Again, thank you so much for joining today's session, and I really appreciate you taking the time. Let me hand it over to Chandra Prakash to get started. CP, over to you.
Thanks, Anupam, and everyone, welcome to today's webinar. So first of all, we are going to see today a very interesting topic about cyber security in pharma companies, because this is what is creating the buzz in the market. We know that in India, the pharma industry is a sunrise sector. Even from the stock market perspective, top 10 pharma companies have increased their market capitalization almost twice. And pharma industry in India is projected to reach $55 billion by 2020, which means effectively it will become one of the top three markets. And this information is coming from the PwC, McKinsey, and TechSci Research. Now, if we see the pharma industry spread in industry in India, it can be divided into three parts. One, there are generic drug manufacturers. There are those pharma companies that sell off-patented, cost-effective drugs at low prices, because there is no specific brand name or patent associated with that. The second kind of companies are patented drugs, basically the companies who sell drugs through in-house research or they have licenses from patent holders. The third is CRAMS, which primarily do contract research and manufacturing services. Basically, the intellectual property is owned by someone else and via a royalty and on contract, either research or the manufacturing is being done on the other firm's behalf. Now, what we have done is that we have done a quick survey, and some part is based on our internal experience. We identified the top five risks that today India pharmaceutical companies face. One is GMP compliance. Obviously, GMP is general good management practices, and as a part of CFR 21, CFR 11, some part of it is related directly to cybersecurity, specifically on the security and integrity. So this is the biggest risk as far as 23% of the respondents states. The second is intellectual property protection, because there are more and more Indian pharma companies who are doing research. They have intellectual property which can go to competition as well as can get leaked. Not only that, because the contract manufacturing is on the rise, so all contractual requirements, pricing formula, new product information, all these things are intellectual property, and 22% of the respondents say that intellectual property protection is the second topmost cybersecurity risk that they face. The third is related to privacy, both from the perspective of customer as well as from the perspective of employees. The fourth is insider threats. This is increasing, obviously, because of disgruntled employees as well as people who are jumping jobs from one company to another. This is a common problem of many different types of industries, and always in single digits. And then last is the fraud, in terms of not reporting exactly the license terms and conditions to save money and do the royalty protection. So these are the top five risks in pharma companies. Now, what are the top five reasons because of which this risk arises? One is the manual processes. As we know that GMP CFR requirements is for having a standard operating procedures for everything that we do, right from the testing, production, manufacturing, etc. There are operating processes, but most of the operating processes for executing the standard operating procedures are manual in nature. So this gives rise to data integrity issues. It also gives rise to human errors, and it also gives rise to certain controls which cannot be enforced. Second is technical control limitation. Though there are basic technical controls in all pharma companies, right from having segregated network, development, production, they have certain controls in terms of physical security and temperature controls and the conditions that are required for pharmacy production. But there are other facts which are related to information security, data security, and technical controls at the endpoint, which primarily lacks. A quick example can be given that most of the firms, they do have certain DLPs for protecting intellectual property to be moving out from their endpoint, web, and email, but they lack comprehensive data security controls with respect to sharing of information outside of the corporate boundary or working through BYOD devices or some of the applications that are on the cloud, wherein the same controls cannot be consistently and extended to all different kinds of environments. The third is reason for this risk is skill and awareness among employees and customers, wherein people are either not trained or they are not aware, and there are a lot of human errors that happen because of which, during execution of manual processes, because of which you end up creating cybersecurity mistakes. The fourth is operational risk, which are seen in silos, and primarily they are reactive in nature, which means that I am not looking at security as an end-to-end way in the mean. I am trying to solve point problems with point tools. So for BYOD, I try solving it by MDM. Data security, I solve it by DLP. Some cloud security, maybe I am trying to solve it controls either at the cloud service provider or through CASB, etc. But what I do not have is a model by which I can identify the sensitive data and then protect via technical process and governance control across the lifecycle, irrespective of which system, which mobile device, where cloud, which application it is stored, transferred, shared, and archived. The last is lack of monitoring and detection control. We have seen that while banks, financial services, insurance, telecommunication companies have embraced security operation centers, have matured it with security analytics, created better use cases, and integrated a lot of data security privacy controls into their SOC. In the pharma industry, we see that the monitoring controls and detection controls are not as good as compared to BFSIs and telco. So these are the top five reasons because of which we have risk in pharma sectors. Now what we are going to do is that in the subsequent slide, we will see that what are the information security drivers for Indian pharma companies. So obviously regulatory compliance is number one driver for any type of industry. It is the compliance that force companies to implement controls, have policies, standard operating procedures and technical controls, get assurance and audits from third parties, not only to them, but to also extended enterprise and vendors. The second is intellectual property and data protection, because pharma companies are IP heavy, their formulas, contracts, pricing mechanisms, etc. So intellectual property becomes the core of the pharma company's valuation. So it is not the controls that they have, purely from asset perspective. Their valuation is tremendous because of the licenses they possess or contracts they have or the IP that they have developed using research. They spend sometimes as high as 10% of their revenue into IP creation, which eventually brings tremendous value, sometimes 4 to 5 times the entire enterprise value. So extremely important from the protection point of view. The third is reason or information security driver is risk management, not just from the perspective of having security governance and as a part of larger enterprise risk strategy, but also from the perspective of protecting IPs and other sensitive information, be it employees, customers, contracts, from insider threats as well as from external threats. And one critical part of the risk management is also having robust monitoring and incident response mechanism. The fourth driver is extended enterprise. We have seen that pharma companies are more and more dependent on third parties for some of the other business efficiencies. Either it can be licensing deal or research facility or just manufacturing facility which is outside or clinical trials, so on and so forth. So any inconsistency in security and privacy requirements with their extended enterprise and they connecting to the larger pharma companies becomes a risk management story or a driver for implementing controls. The last is operational efficiency, wherein we are talking about how can we leverage security analytics to reduce cost, improve security posture, and do decision making and governance faster, and also how can we look at automation in GRC so that we do regulatory compliance both from internal policy, CFR 11, and any other compliance that is required from contract manufacturing perspective with the parent pharma companies or from where we have obtained the contracts, and how we can demonstrate this compliance. The automation story plays a lot of role and is a major driver for automation, not only the controls, but also the control assurance and reporting piece. So let's move on to the next slide. Now that we have seen the information security challenges, we will quickly see the details of the drivers. As I said, the first is the regulatory compliance. We have compliance requirements from GMP, FDA 21, CFR 11, internal policies, and contracts from parent companies. The cost of non-compliance is huge, as good as sometimes for data security and controls of non-repudiation. We have seen some of the contracts getting cancelled or ban on drug selling into the largest market, which is US. So to avoid this, we definitely need a lot of investment and consistency in controls around it and ability to prove that we comply and the standard operating procedure for everything that we have. So what is the challenge? Challenge is that we don't have a single view of compliance requirements for a large MNC company, which is applicable across systems, research, and manufacturing facilities that we can ensure. We also have new and changing requirements, and what we have to ensure that whatever is mentioned in the SOPs, you know, adhered to in every intent and spirit, and we should have ability to prove that. If we do not have that definition of operating environment clearly, then we are going to have a lot of interpretation and ability to provide reasonable assurance to the compliance officers, and we will end up getting NCs. The third challenge is that system data, user architecture, SOPs, incident response, monitoring, and compliance are actually not defined, owners are not defined, and the cost of managing these programs, both in silos and lack of automation, is again a big regulatory challenge. So the need of the R is to basically provide a consistency, definition of operating environment, end-to-end compliance, and automation, so that you have a single view of all the applicable requirements that you have, with clearly defined owners for ensuring an adherence, and ability to prove that your SOPs are adhered to. The second is intellectual property and sensitive data protection. Primary challenges around data governance, sensitive data identification, is visibility across the sensitive data movement within and outside the organization. Also, identification of the data leakage points and controls around it, and lack of awareness. So these are the first and second key drivers for the key risks that we have seen earlier. Moving on to the next slide. Some technical challenge. Yeah, so the third one is the extended enterprise and automation of GRC. So we have an extended enterprise where we have given a lot of research and other contract related work, maybe for research, clinical trials, or manufacturing. And we want to adhere that whatever we have provided to the other companies is security and privacy requirements, and they also follow the same process, same SOPs that we have defined for ourselves, and we should have the ability to manage and provide assurance to our compliance officers. So, moving on to the next slide. Yep. Extended operational efficiencies, as we said that we need to automate the monitoring, which is from the perspective of threat, vulnerabilities, compliance, segregation of duties, and data insight. What we need is a mechanism by which we can prove the maker and checker concept, ability to implement and automate the controls around segregation of duties, ensure that we are doing continuous compliance monitoring, and we also have the ability to consolidate operations from the perspective of identity, access, federation, so that we can manage the access and to sensitive data, and also have a single source of truth so that we can control them. So these are basically the challenges. And now what I will do is that for getting into insights into compliance and data protection requirement, which was our challenge number one and two, I will hand it over to our lead consultant for risk and compliance assurance, Mr. Anand, and Anand and I will run you through that.
All right, thank you, CP. So I'm going to briefly touch upon the information. obviously the key concerns from a regulatory standpoint is the protocol automation. So basically, you know, whenever a new drug is being formulated, you know, from an investigational standpoint, this compliance requires that, you know, each and every step is identified down to the specific computer system which is used for the written study protocol, how the protocol is submitted to the IND or investigational new drug unit, and how the ID applications are raised. So it talks about automation at various levels, and it also talks about ensuring non-remediation and reconciliatory controls with respect to the compliance requirement. Access management is another key area which regulators focus on, you know, extensively. So from a 21 CFR Part 11 perspective, the compliance requirement mandates that each and every operator or each and every employee that's involved with testing of drugs or right from, you know, in the drug manufacture and conception process have unique logins, have unique accounts, and it's also prudent that, you know, the company has appropriate password policies that stipulate that users have unique identities and, you know, their identities are established. So it talks about password length, password strength, combination, etc. And it's not just enough that having, you know, you need to have good authentication controls. The login and logout should be periodically audited, and there should be a reconciliation process defined in the organization. And this has to be, you know, a formal process which has to be demonstrated over a period of time. Backup and restore is another key compliance concern, because unlike most of the, you know, like CBO was saying about BFSI industries or certain other industries, which have compliance requirements of data retention, but data retention for those industries is approximately, you know, 7 to 10 years at the most. But in pharmaceutical industries, data retention and recovery, you know, takes a whole new perspective because the retention requirements have just, you know, drastically gone up. So, for example, if a new drug is conceived and it gets FDA approval and it's released into the market, there is a requirement that, you know, that the pharmaceutical company retains the entire documentation and they preserve the integrity of all the documentation and the test results for the entire duration or lifetime that the drug is in circulation in the markets. So, for example, you could have a medicine that's developed today, and you know, it could be available, you know, across the markets for the next 35, 40 years. So, it is required that you maintain all the clinical trial data, all the test results, and everything that went into creating the drug in the intact form, without having any of the data compromised or without having integrity questioned. So, that's easier said than done, especially if you have to retain that chain of custody evidence for a period of 35 to 40 years. So, backup and restore, it's not just enough that you go for traditional backup and restore solutions. We need to look at backup and restore and, you know, BCP from a holistic perspective to ensure that, you know, the system maintains integrity and all restore records have that integrity verified. The other, obviously, you know, the other important compliance concern is standard operating procedures. So, so basically, this specifically states that, you know, draft operating procedures need to be created, those procedures need to be aware. So each and every test cycle, each and every production instance need to have procedures appropriately documented and authorized. And the documents should be made available to people, whether it's in a hard copy format or an electronic format. And the document should also be available for inspection by the FDA as and when required as part of an audit. So these are some key compliance requirements. So audit trail is another important compliance pain point. Wherein you had to keep track of, you know, pharmaceutical companies had to keep track of all their creations, modifications, deletions, whether any specific electronic record is tampered by an individual, whether any data, you know, integrity is affected or data is parsed and rewritten. So each and every aspect of, you know, testing has to be audit trailed and secured, and this has to be proved with a timestamp that there are no changes to that specific record. And it's also important that, you know, computer systems are configured and, you know, securely, and also they, you know, record an appropriate timestamp and maintain change records accurately. Internet security is a very important aspect. So basically, CFR Part 11 states that any secure system or any clinical system that's involved in the production of drugs or any system that's involved in taking measurements or taking readings for drug tests and clinical trials, they need to be in a separate network altogether, not from the network should not be part of the standard corporate network, which is open to the internet or which is exposed to other networks. So there should be appropriate firewall controls, there should be separate VLANs, separate ACL lists maintained, and all communication from the operator to the server should be encrypted, and it should have appropriate data protection controls as well. You know, touching upon DLP controls and controls which ensure that non-repudiation and integrity are maintained. So it's very important, segregation is a very important aspect. source document retention and data entry a key aspect here. So especially when data is transmitted from one system to another, even if it's within the same intranet network, there should be appropriate controls, appropriate levels of controls. Chain of custody has to be maintained, and you know, the copies should be produced securely, and there should be appropriate roles and data entry limitations to ensure that the copies are not tampered with. Data management is another key compliance requirement, especially with respect to direct data entry. So this is again, you know, going back to the earlier discussion regarding testing procedures. Most of the data for clinical trials ideally should be automated, but in instances where, you know, testing is done manually, so the bigger challenge is how do you maintain integrity of that test? How do you ensure that, you know, test results are captured correctly, right from the environmental climatic conditions to the test subjects' medical conditions to the effectiveness of the drug, et cetera. So data management plays a very important role. And it's also important from an evidence standpoint, because in case of any FDA investigations or any audits, you should be able, the company should be able to reconstruct the source documentation for an audit review. And digital, last but not the least, one really most important requirement from a compliance standpoint is digital signatures. So it's important that the organization has a sound PKI setup, and there are procedures to manage keys, to back up keys, and also rotate keys, just in order to ensure that the integrity of the data and digital signature is not compromised. So if we move on to the next slide, so the next slide basically talks about a brief summary of the data protection. So we saw the compliance aspect. The next question is, as a pharmaceutical organization, what exactly are we trying to protect here? What exactly are these compliance requirements trying to address? So obviously, for any organization, especially pharmaceutical organization, what you could protect is your crown jewels, right? So this could be your intellectual property, your clinical data, research data, drug formulations, clinical trial data, patient history, health information, marketing information, etc. That forms the whole gamut of the crown jewels that's defined in the organization. So typically, once you define the crown jewels, the next question from a classification and information security standpoint is, how do I protect it? So you have the whole gamut of information cybersecurity, wherein you define policies, create a cybersecurity governance framework, which would again detail specific implementation scenarios, which talks about what kind of security controls need to go in at various levels to protect data from a holistic standpoint. Now you can see there are specific individual security components listed here, like data leakage prevention, DAM, IRM, encryption, etc. So obviously these are the questions that, you know, most companies have. Is DLP enough? Should we extend coverage to include database activity monitoring to ensure that everything is logged and audit trailed? And what type of encryption, what levels of encryption are required at various stages? You know, for data in transit, for data at rest in databases, and what are the policies to set and enforce? How do we correlate and how do we get a consolidated dashboard to ensure that our information security posture is up to a specific level and that we meet the compliance requirements from the industry standpoint. So basically, it's not enough that we, you know, as CP was saying earlier in one of the slides, it's not enough that we address security as a point-based requirement, but rather, every organization, especially pharmaceutical companies, should, create a master cybersecurity plan which talks about information security governance, how is security going to be managed in the organization, and then detail down to the technical solutions that's going to back up and enforce those security policies. So moving on to the next slide. So this is basically a small example, or you can say it's basically a synopsis of a small case study, you know, wherein, so how does the, FDA compliance and regulatory compliance come into picture from a, you know, testing perspective? So basically some of the principles are, you identify systems in test and production that need FDA compliance. So for example, here in our, in the pharmaceutical example, it would be your research systems, your systems that where you store your drug formula, where the formulation was done, the systems which actually are used for clinical trials, for recording tests. You know, one classic example would be, you know, let's say an organization X is developing a medicine to increase hemoglobin count in patients that have low blood count. So one example would be to, you know, the trials, the subject who is part of the trial could have his blood sample put into a system. And that would automatically record the hemoglobin level, the blood levels, et cetera, and it would transfer that information securely to a central server. So now the question is, so this is from when it's done electronically and automatically, but what if that's being recorded manually by a human user? So there has to be integrity controls to ensure that the information entered is accurate. So for example, if if it says the hemoglobin count is, you know, 98% or 29%. So when the operator enters it into the system, it shouldn't translate into 100% or 35%. So that way, you know, the integrity of the data is lost. So these are some requirements which the FDA talks about. So you segregate FDA-regulated computer systems. That's what 21 CFR Part 11 talks about. So all systems that contribute to test and clinical trial and clinical research are part of the regulated system, regulated computer network. It's in a separate logical network. It's separate from the corporate network. It's firewall, and it's specifically access controlled and access limited to specific people who are involved in the testing purpose. Some of the other aspects would be to log traffic coming in and out of the system separately and to authenticate specific group of users within a company. So, for example, the other item would be like who are the clinical operators, what are their unique IDs. So only those specific people should have identities established on those systems, and only they should have you know, access to those specific production instances or test instances. So it's also important that, you know, the company maintains a regular audit trail, and frequent audit is conducted on a periodic basis to ensure that the access controls and the appropriate controls are working as expected. And some of the steps that you can take would be to segregate clinical trial and research applications and databases into separate zones. So basically, you deploy them in a separate DM. Additional encryption to support an augmented requirement. And, you know, these are some of the steps, like setting up a network and, you know, production is for pulling the data and for testing. So that's one aspect where you can have a test network with no internet, with no direct access to the production network. So this would be the primary network from the FDA regulated computer system, that where you can actually carry out the tests, where you can pull in metering and test data. And you need not pull it directly from the specific systems. And obviously, the most important aspect would be to document all standard operating procedures. So no matter how the testing is happening, no matter how the research is happening, or what are the steps that goes into formulation of drugs, etc., each and every instance of the testing should be documented, and in a standard operating procedure should be developed for each and every phase. And this documentation should be version control, timestamp, and it should be regularly reviewed and maintained. So this will act as a maker checker for all clinical and research data with appropriate electronic signatures. So this is regulatory compliance and this is basically how we are going to translate the compliance requirement and how we are going to actually design a framework and get compliant to those specific requirements like 21 CFR Part 11 and GMP. So with that, I would like to move on to the next phase. That would be on the identity and access management plan. So I would like to hand over to my colleague, Deepak Simon.
Thanks, Anand, for that. So hello, everyone. This is Deepak here. So I'll be talking a few minutes about, identity and access management and how it will apply to a pharmaceutical industry. So thank you for your time. So we'll move on to the initial slide for identity and access management. So what we're addressing is, why would pharmaceutical industry need an identity and access management solution. So, CP has provided a background about, the cybersecurity risk and, top five reasons. So the primary reason an identity and access management system is provided is a setup in a pharmaceutical industry is primarily for automation. Currently, most of, organizations would be following a manual process for requesting access. Audit trails would be over paper. Now, all of this, becomes very unwieldy because more and more applications are being developed, more and more users are accessing online. So a lot of things are getting, transformed into digital systems. So when it comes to an IT team, they are always faced with the challenge of ever-increasing work, and they need automation to do the normal activities of providing access, disabling access, removing access. All this needs to be automated. So that's one of the primary reasons where an IT of a pharmaceutical organization would want to go for identity and access management system. Now, that is just one of the primary drivers, but once you put in such a system, you realize the benefits of it. The benefits, though it is usually part of an IT system, the benefits accrue to the InfoSec team as well. Because now, because of the very nature of an identity and access management system, which is a centralized solution, it's basically like an ERP, just like, you know, you would implement an ERP and get all information related to, you know, inventory, financials, and everything is in a central ERP solution. Same way, identity management provides a centralized solution for all identity and access information. So you no longer have to go and dig up an audit trail as to who approved an access, when it was accessed. And so all the things is now available as part of a centralized solution. So it can, you know, and this is as a, you know, nowadays most organizations are now extending their boundaries from, you know, just being IT solutions for internal users to actually interface and enable their business partners to access their systems or access the business partner system. So the traditional user has stopped being not just an internal user, but also business partners and, you know, for the pharmaceutical industry, it might be, you know, contract research organizations, clinical trial organizations that, you know, provide services or data management services to, you know, pharmaceutical company. So, basically what happens is now with a centralized solution, you can have a reference point to, you know, provide all audit trails and information as to who has access to what systems. Most of the times, a CIO or a security head is faced with the challenge of, you know, finding out if there is a user, you know, what access does he have to, what systems does he has access to. So all this can be provided from a single point. We can enforce segregation of duties, not just within an application, but between applications. And you can also have, you know, manage the user's lifecycle by interfacing the IAM system with the HR system so that, you know, if a person is put on a watch list or if a person is, you know, let go, you don't have to scramble and go to each and every IT system to disable their access or remove their access. It can be done from a central point, which is identity and access management system. The third major point is about, you know, risk-based access. Now, when you are using a digital system, you want to put in controls as to access, when they are accessing these systems, are they accessing it during office hours, are they accessing it outside office hours, or are they accessing it from, you know, a remote system, maybe a mobile device, or, you know, from a cyber cafe. So you want to restrict the access based upon dynamic and varying number of factors. That is where risk-based access comes in. We can do, you know, risk profiling and risk scoring to allow access. We can maybe, you know, if we assume that, you know, the person is accessing from an insecure location, we can have a, you know, step-up authentication or you know, OTP-based multi-factor authentication before having the person access the relevant system. So all this becomes very important in case of a pharmaceutical which wants to control access to, you know, its intellectual property or, you know, clinical data or test data and things like that. The last is basically insider threat prevention. You know, obviously one of the major reasons for data breaches, in fact, you know, though hacking is usually considered, you know, a very high critical, you know, risk factor for, you know, organizations and very much in the news, but the primary fact is that most of the data exfiltration happens through insiders. When they move companies, they take a bunch of data with them, or they, you know, save the data onto, you know, external drives, or they upload data onto, you know, from cloud-based solutions, you know, even probably for sharing with, you know, their business partners. So what we have is that, you know, we can do a real-time monitoring of this access how their user is accessing, you know, can have a behavior analytics, and we can also have a feedback loop such that, you know, the person is educated first that, okay, this is not acceptable behavior, this is unacceptable, you are not supposed to, use Dropbox to share, sensitive information. So then we can go on to, investigating, prevention, we can block access if the person continues with that kind of activity. So there's a whole gamut of solutions available to prevent insider threats, and not just, blocking access, but primarily educating users to the problem, because most of the time when a user is told that it is unacceptable behavior, they then stop doing it. So there's a effective deterrence over there. So all this form as a primary, need and relevant need for a pharmaceutical industry. So the next slide is basically on, how do we address such needs using identity and access management solutions. Now, identity and access management solutions are, a wide area of products. You have, identity lifecycle management, multi-factor authentication, privileged access management, insider threat monitoring, remote access monitoring. So these are all primarily solutions that can be used by organizations depending upon where their focus area is. So usually when an organization starts their identity and access management journey, it is usually with automation. That is the most important thing. That is the most painful area. Probably next would be single sign-on because, a user has access to so many applications. They have usually different passwords to access, and sometimes they forget the password. They go for holidays, come back, and, there's a huge amount of password resets that need to be done. So IT and helpdesk team are usually have their hands full by resetting passwords. So usually what we see is, after automation, if a customer goes for a single sign-on solution, they bring down their helpdesk cost by 80% because that is roughly the amount of time spent on, resetting passwords and, providing access or rectifying access. So these things are the top benefits that come out of identity and access management solution that ultimately adds to the cost savings. So not just if there is the help in terms of automation and centralized audit trails and centralized approvals and authorizations. All this helps ultimately in increasing efficiency and decreasing cost over the long term. So this is basically a quick overview of how an IAM system or solutions can help the pharmaceutical industry's real needs, day-to-day needs. So basically, now we should be open to questions. I'll just hand it over to CP for a quick rundown of the summary, and then we can be open for questions.
Hey, thanks, Deepak. This is Anupam. Thanks, guys. Thanks for an informative session. We do have a few questions coming from the audience. Let me start asking those questions. Hey, someone is on speakerphone. Can you please put on mute, please? Okay, let me ask those questions. The first question is related to IP protection against insider threat. So the question is, protect IP. I think, Deepak, you already covered this area in general, but I think the question is very specific to IP, saying that how can you protect against insider threat from an IP perspective? So how can access control and governance help in this area? So question, would you want to take this question, Deepak?
Yeah, sure. So, so basically, there are access control solutions available that can dynamically, you know, analyze, you know, various parameters of a user's access. Some of these parameters would be, you know, which location he's accessing from, which device he's accessing from, is he accessing, you know, outside business hours. So we can have, so basically there is fingerprinting done, and there is no need to register any particular, you know, user's device or location. This all happens on the fly. So when a request comes in through a browser access or through a mobile device access, the solution automatically, you know, that it calculates the risk score. So for it, there is a rule saying that, okay, you know, access from a particular location outside India is not allowed. Say the request, the IP address originates out of China or outside or from Russia or some other place where the organization has decided it's too high a risk and we don't want that to be enabled. The access will be denied automatically, even though the person has actually given a valid user ID and password. The other option is obviously that, okay, it might be a legitimate user. We would want him to do a second factor authentication. So just to be sure that, you know, it is our person. So we can send out, solution will send out a mobile SMS-based OTP to the user, and if he has access to his mobile at that point, he can enter that OTP to gain access. If the OTP is wrong or it is not filled out, then basically, again, the request is denied. So that way we can have a number of, you know, access controls, you know, risk-based access controls built in, not just for IP, but also for location, devices, business hours, and things like that.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Deepak. The second question I have is related to data security. So I think the question is very interesting. The thing is that since there's a genuine need for sharing data across the offices, corporate offices, data center, manufacturing facilities, vendors, and this could be across regions. So how do we typically manage data security? Given that any pharma companies has distributed distributed facilities, distributed offices, and there could be vendors and third-party agencies involved in the overall process, how can we manage the data security as it flows across all those different things? Question is probably for Anand. Anand, do you want to take this question?
Yeah, sure, Anupam. So that's a good question. So basically, you know, from a data security standpoint, there is no one specific way to you know, ensure that data is protected, but there could be a myriad or a combination of various controls. So the first and foremost aspect would be for all internal users. You know, we fall back on the internal controls from the organization, from ELP-related controls to enforcing you know, file restrictions and data type restrictions on what kind of information can be sent out. And in the instance where, you know, let's say that you need to legitimately send specific trial data or research data to your, let's say, one of your partners, in those instances, there should be, you know, apart from email, there should be a specific communication channel for them. So, like, for example, you could have a B2B connection, you could be an encrypted connection, or you could have any specific data share or repository, secure repositories established where you can transfer the data seamlessly over an encrypted network. The other option would be to minimize the kind of data that can go on email. So this can be, again, enforced by the DLP. So you can limit file types, file sizes, and you can actually specify additional encryption, like PGP or any specific encryption types to be applied to specific data components. So it can be as simple as enabling TLS on email. From a technical standpoint, we need to look at layering the organization with appropriate data classification guidelines. And part of that would be to conduct a data flow analysis where we figure out what type of data is created at which instances, and once it's created, how is it consumed, what are the various channels for people to which the data moves, and to ultimately how the data archived or disposed of. So once we get a map of this, we can specify what kind of specific tools need to be implemented at a technical level to enforce data restrictions and prevent any data leak or abuse or other agencies. So that's broadly, you know, how it goes.
Okay.
I hope that answers your questions.
Thanks, Anand. The third question we have is related to Aujas and how can we as a company help in this area as to what are the services we offer specific to pharma industry and how can we help companies in the pharma sector to take care of information security. Anand, do you want to take this question? I think we have a deck at the end of this which I can bring up and maybe you can talk about it.
Yeah, sure.
Can you guys see my deck?
Yes. Yep. So let me start. So what we do is that we have a holistic framework to deal with cybersecurity in pharmaceutical company. We do not see them as working in silos, but we work with all the silos. It's a interlocking jigsaw pieces. So they work with each other to deliver the effective security solutions. The GRC framework that we have brings actually the strategy, governance, policy framework, technology controls, and then sustenance and operations piece into one. So what effectively it means that we spoke about top five security risks that we have, right from regulatory compliance to data security and intellectual property protection to insider threats management, wherein many controls play around. Controls are related to identity management, access governance. They also deal with technical controls, ability to prove non-repudiation, PKI. When you are sharing information with third parties, then you are talking about rights management, so on and so forth. So if you see, holistically, if we have to address this, what we need is a set of cybersecurity strategies, governance, and policies. So first of all, we need to make this. Develop a cybersecurity framework which consists of governance and strategy at the top, followed by policies, processes, procedure, and then it is followed by risk assessment, then followed by technical controls to mitigate the risks, and then followed by operational process and procedure. Then we create an information security program which is specific to each of the units, and then we create a set of security technologies based on the risk assessment. Say, for example, we touched base on data security in the last question, and we spoke about how we can protect data when we have data centers located in X locations, manufacturing facilities in Y and Z, have corporate office somewhere, and we also have certain contract manufacturing facilities or vendors who are processing our sensitive information. So you take this as an example and see that how your information security program for data security works. So basically you identify your sensitive information and you identify the life cycle of the sensitive information. So from where that information is created or added, how you share that information, where you store that information, who has access to that information, how it is used and shared with third parties, and then how it is archived. Now each of these, the touch points can be technical control systems like application or databases, or for that matter, many other different types of mechanisms. Then you have applications where this information is being used to access, and the storage might be file server, database, SAP system, so on and so forth. And then the way it is being shared is by extracting the information from the system or directly in the system. So when you share the information outside of the system, obviously you get it into some format. And then you're talking about archival and having the control over it. So in this entire life cycle, you see, if we can identify how the information was created, the intellectual property or any other sensitive information, contracts, so on and so forth. If it is shared with email, then we are talking about risk as leakage and spoofing. So we are talking about encryption. Then if it is stored in application, we are talking about application security, access management. If we are talking about information stored in database, again, there we are talking about segregation of duties, administrative controls, monitoring, identity management, access management, non-repudiation, logging for every access for that sensitive information, etc. Then when that information moves from one part to another, you know, before sharing it with third party, then we are talking about file servers. And then when it is shared with third parties, we are talking about digital rights management, so on and so forth. So what we need to do is that we need to create a holistic program which consists of standard operating procedures, a set of policies and process, governance, and ability to identify sensitive information, do data classification, identify with whom, what, where, when, and how this information is shared, and then put technical controls around all the ecosystem, which may be email, applications, database, file servers, so on and so forth. Then we are talking about operations. Once we have implemented identity management solution, access management solution, you have to operate those solutions. You have to continuously prove that you are compliant. You have to assure, you have to manage incidents, you have to enhance, so on and so forth. The same thing goes with DLP, wherein you have to constantly move your use cases and rule bases, do DLP incident management, rights management, access controls, segregation of duty reports, continuous role-based access control management depending on employees' exit in and out. Hence, our framework basically is complete and cohesive. You can take in bits and pieces as a service and apply it if you have a point problem, like I am only looking at access governance. That solution we can provide. If you want your comprehensive program of coming and doing a cybersecurity gap assessment or a GMP, FDA 21, CFR 11 compliance, then we can only provide regulatory compliance and ITGRC automation solution. If you are looking at data security and you want to protect your top five data and you want us to come meet your different business units, create a data governance model, data classification policy, do data flow analysis to identify the data movement in business processes, and then apply controls and manage them, we can do that. So in a nutshell, how we can help is that we have an entire program. And you can say that we have strategy and governance piece, then we have policies, process, procedure piece, we have risk assessment, we have technical controls, and then we have operations and sustenance services. So that's how we can help all different size scales of pharma companies, local, multinational, to help address them.
Thanks, CP. That was really informative. So this kind of brings us to the end of today's session. I know there are some audio issues towards the end of it, so we'll be sharing the recording as well as the presentation with all of you. We sincerely hope it was a useful session for everyone. And thank you so much for joining us today. And you have a good day, rest of the day. And thanks for joining today. Thanks, CP. Thanks, Anand and Deepak. Thanks for joining today's session and doing the session. Thank you.